We are finally ready to investigate quantum key distribution. It might surprise you that the idea of quantum key distribution is actually much older than most people might think. Already in the 70s, in fact, early 70s, Stephen Wiesner wrote a paper called Conjugate Coding that proposed several cool ideas in cryptography, including quantum money, for example. Amongst them was also the idea that one can use quantum states to enable secure communication. As you can see from this quote, this idea was not particularly popular at that time, as it sometimes goes with new ideas. Thankfully, people later came up with very concrete quantum key distribution protocols, which are in fact still used today, after which QKD gained in popularity. In 1984, Charles Bennett and Gilles Brassard wrote a paper called Quantum Cryptography, Public Key Distribution and Coin Tossing. This is possibly one of the most famous quantum key distribution protocols up to this day, and it is in fact also being implemented now in 2016. Crucially, there are also protocols based on entanglement, and this idea was invented by Arthur Eckert in 1991, leading to a protocol which is called E91. This protocol uses entanglement and properties of entanglement to establish the security of QKD. The perspective of entanglement forms the basis of all modern security proofs for QKD. Where is quantum key distribution today? Quantum key distribution is in fact commercially implemented on short distances. There's quite a lot of companies that do that, ID Quantique for example, Toshiba, Huawei and NEC. I will not talk about this here, since we will have a very special guest lecture for you, Nicolas Gisin from Geneva, who will tell you more about their efforts to realize quantum key distribution commercially. Before we go into quantum key distribution, where we will construct protocols and we will prove that they are secure, it is useful to remember what we exactly want to protect against and what resources Alice and Bob have. So what we want, of course, is a key distribution protocol. And as before, Alice and Bob are in impenetrable labs. So certainly the eavesdropper cannot access and figure out what's going on inside. We will later relax this condition somewhat, but for the moment think that there's absolutely nothing going in and out of Alice's lab. Alice and Bob have full knowledge and control of their quantum devices. Alice and Bob also have a random number generator that generates random numbers, which are only known to them, but not to Eve. You can see that the random number generators are inside their lab. They can use this randomness in the course of the protocol. Alice and Bob are connected by a quantum communication channel. Because, as you might imagine, quantum key distribution requires them to send qubits. And we will, for the moment, also assume that they are connected by a classical authenticator channel. They can send classical bits to each other over the channel. Eve knows these bits, but Alice and Bob can be sure that the bits really came from the other party. We will later take this condition away and we will explain to you how Alice and Bob can create a classical authenticated channel. This is the scenario with only Alice and Bob. So what about Eve? What can she do? The first thing that we should remember is that in all quantum cryptographic protocols, in fact, in all cryptographic protocols, the attacker knows the protocol. Eve knows precisely what Alice and Bob are going to do. Except, of course, for any random numbers that the protocol might ask them to produce. Eve in quantum key distribution is all-powerful. You can think that Eve can control all the universe except the labs of Alice and Bob. In particular, Eve has a quantum computer, she has an arbitrary quantum memory, and she spends essentially all her time trying to read the secrets of Alice and Bob. Eve also sees a perfect quantum channel. Of course, in a real implementation, Alice and Bob will experience noise in the transmission even if there's no eavesdropper Eve present at all. But if Eve is there, she can, magically, eliminate all of these imperfections. Hence, all noise could really be due to Eve's interference. So what precisely does QKD, quantum key distribution, accomplish? We've already talked about what key distribution is, and certainly it should thus satisfy our two conditions. First of all, it should be correct, meaning that the key KA that Alice outputs and the key KB that Bob outputs are equal to each other, except with some small error probability epsilon. The protocol should also be secure, in the sense that the state they produce has the following form, namely Eve is almost ignorant about the key. Remember what this approximately equal to means. It means that the state they produce, if rho is epsilon close to sigma, it means that the trace distance between rho and sigma is small. So why is this the right definition of security in the case of quantum key distribution? Remember that the definition of the trace distance is precisely related to how well the two states can be distinguished. So if two states are epsilon close in trace distance, when epsilon is extremely small, this means that no process in the universe can distinguish the states very well. In particular, it also means that if we were to use a key inside a larger protocol, for example, in a one-time paired encryption scheme that uses the key produced by quantum key distribution, then the resulting protocol will hardly see any difference whether we use the real state or the ideal state, where Eve is completely ignorant. This is because if it could see a difference, this would constitute a measurement that would allow us to distinguish the real from the ideal case. But we precisely know that this is impossible by the properties of the trace distance. We have now seen what we want to achieve, so let's get started with constructing an actual protocol for quantum key distribution.